My name is Hans Chen, and as the title says, I'm going to be talking about automotive over-the-air software updates, give a little introduction to how it works, some of the opportunities that it brings, and some of the challenges. So let's see what's showing up. Before I begin, just a quick disclaimer, I don't work for Intrepid. This presentation has been created by me, and the views, opinions, and content here are just entirely my own. All right, with that out of the way, I'd like to thank Intrepid for hosting this event. I've used their products in the past, their hardware, their software, and as our previous speaker has indicated, their hardware works very well with custom-made programs. I've used three or four of them. In fact, one of them led the development on to validate infotainment production, so very useful. And also, I'd like to thank Oakland University and the School of Engineering and Computer Science for their support as well. All right, so let's get started. I know we're running a little bit behind schedule, so I'm going to ask that any questions that you have are directed after the presentation. I'll be at the lobby and also after the networking event. All right, we're going to start real simple and then just got more and more detail. So we know that software updates can fix or mitigate issues, and they can also make things better after you bought them. So software updates are good. They're great. And there's a lot of software inside vehicles because a lot of components have some type of electronic control. And if there's ever something that needs to be improved or fixed, by simply changing the software, we can change the way the vehicle works. How do we know if we're going to need a software update? Well, I've created this matrix here. If we have a feature that is relatively new to the market, that's a higher risk. So that's the x-axis at the bottom. If it's relatively stable, we don't have to worry about it as much because we assume that most of the bugs have been taken care of. And then the other consideration is what's the risk of not updating? So these two categories, autonomous vehicles and electrification, obviously these are great candidates for being updated frequently. So why over the air software updates? And I just want to bring some definitions down. So what I mean in this talk is delivering software to a vehicle, usually using cellular, sometimes Wi-Fi, and to a telematics device. And traditional method has been to use the telematics device to interface with the vehicle's network, communicate with AC, and deliver the software. And this is done without the need of a service station. So a traditional software update is very expensive. In case you didn't know, typically the dealership or other service station is reimbursed $100 every single time this is done by the OEM. And it's inconvenient for the customers, obviously, scheduling and downtime. And over-the-air software updates offer the promise of cheap and convenient updates. Typically, you're spending $5 for each vehicle each time, and primarily that's going to be due to cellular cost and other overhead. So if you imagine that cost difference, $5 versus $100 for a number of vehicles, 10,000, 100,000, a million, right? It starts adding up. And there's some other drivers here. Security, we live in an increasingly connected world. Our cars are going to be different. They'll probably need increased, faster updates. Same thing with safety. If you find an issue, you want to get that update out as quickly as possible. And this allows the software updates to be deployed, especially to customers who might not be within close range of the dealership. And then the other thing is you can offer more features that would have been cost prohibitive to deliver under traditional methods. And if you think about it, how many times will a vehicle be updated in its lifetime? Once? Probably not. Probably at least 10, if not more. 100 times? I think we're getting to that. So if you think of launching a vehicle program, how many times you're going to have to update the vehicles, how many vehicles you have, and the cost of updating those, that's going to be your lifetime update cost. So OTA is critically important. So this brings us to the question, and it's going to be the main focus of this talk. We have mobile phones, we have personal computers that are all very easy to update. We don't plug in wires except for maybe an occasional power cord, and they update just fine. Why not automobiles? Why is it so challenging? Now, things have gotten a little bit better and more developed, but it's still a challenging field. And the focus of my talk will be some of the traditional architectures and design choices that make this so challenging. So what do we mean by updating the car? Now, forgive me for those who know all of this. I'm just starting off again a little bit slow, and then I'll get into more detail. So we have some software, and what does it look like? Well, you're not just updating the quote-unquote car. You're updating one of many different ECUs on the vehicle. And typical vehicle is sold with 30 to 50. And in the OTA world, we call the one that we want to update the target ECU. Now, we can skip this part. Each vehicle has multiple networks, and each network has multiple ECUs on it, and we're trying to target one that just happens to reside on the network. Most ECUs traditionally have had this type of structure where we have what's called the hardware, and there's some locked-in bootloader, and then our main ECU flash memory. So if we're going to use a PC analogy, the bootloader is roughly equivalent to what a BIOS would be, and then the main flash memory would be your standard hard drive or SSD. And the memory is pre-allocated for specific parts. So the application, you could think of that as an .exe file. The application data itself is data that's used by the ECU, and then calibrations allow the ECU to be changed in the way it functions. So instead of rewriting the entire application code for different markets, you could simply place another calibration, say that this vehicle is being sold in Canada, for example, and enable daylight running lights. App data would be equivalent to the navigational data. So instead of having to change the navigation application, you can just change out the new data with a new map update. And the software, of course, will fit into there. The software in the automotive world will typically have a part number, a fixed size, a checksum that we can verify that the integrity is there, and also some hardware software signing. All right, so this is a summary. We've got the vehicle, we've got networks, we've got ECUs that reside on those networks, and then individual chips that are inside and partitions, and that's where our software update is going to go. So how do we deliver it? Typically, in the traditional world, the supplier will come out with the software update. The OEM has its own update cloud. It will prepare an update package and deliver it to the vehicle over the cellular network. And then at that time, the telematics device will deliver the update to the ECU and then send back a status report. And if you're an OEM experiencing a need to update, let's say 10,000 vehicles, every time you get a successful report back, you feel better because, again, you're avoiding a lot of that cost of having that vehicle going to a dealership. Software update package looks something like this. You've got a manifest telling you what you have, and typically it'll also have file integrity checksums for each item to make sure they've been delivered properly, an update script that will give some indication of which ECU you're trying to update, and what type of special modes you want to enable, security credentials for connecting to that particular vehicle, its network, and also to the ECU. And then finally, you have the payload, the software update. Once the software update package arrives, it starts getting applied. So we're usually targeting one of these specific partitions within the chip, but this brings us to one of our many challenges that sets off a whole range of other problems. So traditional ECUs are designed to be in a service station. They're not designed to be over the air updated, and you'll find out why. Automotive grade flash memory is very expensive. It has to survive a lot of noise, heat, vibration, and so it's limited. When a PCB is made on an electronic control unit, and this thing is designed, the memory locations are fixed. They usually weren't designed to be changed afterwards. They're write protected so that they won't get accidentally rewritten except when they're in a service station. But if we're gonna be doing an over-the-air update, we've got to wipe out one of those locations completely before we put in new software. And so during this process, the partitions are erased and new software is placed in, as you can see towards the bottom. And so that part seems pretty easy to understand. So what's the catch? If the software update doesn't complete, the ECU can be unavailable. Remember the analogy of this being kind of like a PC? Well, this would be the equivalent of you losing Windows, or for example, or Mac OS. The computer just won't work. Or for example, some ECUs support just simply rewriting the partition instead of completely erasing it, but a halfway update is just as bad. So what does this mean? Target ECU isn't usable during the software update. And because it's not usable, you're also gonna have to probably disable the vehicle during this time. It's gonna be safe, especially if you're talking about something like an engine controller. So telematics devices typically will have some type of feature functionality that will instruct the vehicle to temporarily disable the ignition, which is great. Disabling a vehicle is inconvenient. How can we make this easier for the driver? I mean, you don't want to accidentally stop the vehicle on some railroad tracks and then start your update, right? So typically the infotainment system is involved here. The infotainment system will do a couple things. It'll tell the driver that there's a vehicle, there's an update available, what the update contains, how long it will take, and give the option either scheduling immediately, or some of the more modern systems allow for scheduling in the evening. So we've disabled the vehicle during the update. Is that all we have to worry about? Oh, 5 minutes. Unfortunately, no, software lives in flash memory, and normally flash memory is very resilient against rewrites, but requires stable and consistent power to update properly when the software update process is happening. So otherwise you get a brick. So most vehicles rely on a 12-volt battery to power all the vehicle electronics, and normally they're asleep when the car is parked, when you open the door and you turn the key on. The engine starts turning the alternator and starts feeding back energy to the battery into all electronics, and then all is good. The problem is when the vehicle is disabled, you're not getting any other additional energy. So electric vehicles, by the way, don't suffer this problem because they have a high voltage battery system that they can rely upon. But internal combustion vehicles do have that issue. So as we said, when the ignition's on, the electrical power stays in that nice green zone. But once ignition's off, the battery starts draining. And if it drains for too long, You enter the danger zone and your update has failed and your ECU doesn't work and your vehicle turns into a brick. So how can we safely update the vehicle, avoid that low power danger zone? Well, there's a couple different techniques. What if we limit the amount of time that an update is allowed to take? So for example, we could say we're not going to allow any updates past 10 or 15 minutes because we know that if we use the, keep the vehicle on without the ignition, the battery will be too low to be safe. So that's one technique that's used. Another issue is that what if the battery power is too low? For example, if the driver doesn't use the vehicle frequently or if battery gets old. So we're assuming that we're starting up there at a nice healthy state, but we're actually lower. What we can do is we can do a battery check beforehand to make sure that we have adequate voltage. And so when we're designing over-the-air updates, we can exclude slow updates, exclude low batteries while we're checking. And there's some other tricks, bus fighting modes and low voltage modes, as discussed by some of our previous speakers. They're really important. And there's Delta files. You can read up about those. But basically, they have two categories of solutions here. We either speed up the update or extend the battery. In an ideal world, we wouldn't have to worry about this at all. So one design technique that you could do is add more flash memory to the chips. So what this would mean is you'd enable a swap space, a temporary location where you can store the update and then allow it to switch once it's completed. If it doesn't finish, there's no worry, right? So you get a safer update. And the other thing it allows is on the fly updates. So you don't have to worry about the driver interaction as much. That update will already be loaded and the driver might just indicate that they, yes, I want this and it'll be done. But the problem is it requires upfront investment. And if you think about, we went back, there's about at least 30 to 50 different ECUs inside of the vehicle that can add up pretty quickly. Some of the talks about zonal controls probably will help because you can consolidate this. So you have to think about long-term, which came first, the funding for extra flash memory or the business need for an over-the-air update. So just a quick summary, given this short talk, if I answered this question, why has over-the-air software updates for automobiles been so challenging with traditional architectures? I hope I did. Thank you for your time.